So welcome to day four of this training course on artificial intelligence and machine learning. And today, for the entire duration of today's lecture, we will be discussing about the artificial neural network. Today, we have three different topics to discuss. The first one is the introductory lecture on artificial neural network. And then I'll be discussing about the architecture of ANN model. And the third lecture will be on the learning mechanism of artificial neural network. Now to start with, artificial neural network forms the backbone of any machine learning system. So we have made a brief introduction about the machine learning technologies on day two. Now to start with, the notion of artificial neural network. First of all, you have to understand what is meant by a nervous system. Normally, if I just consider a biological nervous system, so you must appreciate that this is the most important part of many living things. So we normally talk about the intelligence pertaining to the human beings. So there is a wrong notion that whenever we talk about a nervous system or so, in most of the cases, this is related to or this is associated to a human beings. So that's why it is written like in particular human beings. But as you know, the nervous system, the biological nervous system may be connected to any of the living organisms. So accordingly, the notion of this biological nervous system has been incorporated into what is called the artificial neural network. In fact, this artificial neural network can be thought of as an electrical analog of our biological nervous system. Now, if I just consider the biological nervous system, so the brain is considered to be the most important part, which is at the center of any human nervous system. So although in this particular slide, it has been mentioned that the brain at the center of human nervous system, but you must appreciate the same thing I'm repeatedly saying, that although we always encounter like human nervous system, but it will be better if I consider it like a nervous system of any biological species. So like biological nervous system. So we will refer the term biological nervous system. So brain is the important part. So we never know whether the human is the most clever person in the world, the most intelligent person in the world. There might be some creatures who are even more intelligent than the human being. But anyway, as long as the notion of learning is concerned, and as far as the notion of intelligence is concerned, this nervous system plays an important role. Now, in any biological nervous system, there are a number of small units, intercellular units, and these units are known as neurons, as you understand, and there could have been as many like 10 to the power 11 neurons possible within a particular brain. So as a matter of fact, these neurons carry the essential information within the brain, and ultimately it will control all of our actions. So if I take a look at the dimension of those neurons, so they are very small, so almost approximately like 10 micron long, and they can operate in parallel. And that is the most important part. That is the most important attribute of this machine learning paradigm. So yesterday we have discussed about the searching technique. More specifically, we have talked about breadth first search, depth first search, and different types of searching technique. We have noticed one thing during the searching process. The entire operation is done serially. That means you have started with a particular node, and you have then you have tried to expand that node. And if you get the result, if you have reached the goal, then your action is stopped. And if not, then you have to go back to the parent node, and accordingly, you have to investigate the other nodes as well. So if I consider this searching process in general, so they are serial in nature. That means we cannot expand more than one node at a time. So that is one of the limitations of the traditional searching process, which we have discussed last day. But however, if I consider neural network model, or even for the biological nervous system, there are plenty of neurons. So as I already mentioned, like 10 to the power 11 neurons, as high as this much. And these neurons can operate in parallel. So as a matter of fact, the computation, so as far as the computation is concerned, within the nervous system, the computation is pretty large. A number of computation, complicated operations are being performed inside the brain. But these operations are performed parallelly. And as a matter of fact, the action can be taken from our side instantaneously. For example, if we experience some mosquito bite on our skin, then the corresponding stimulus will reach to the brain within few seconds. And based on the stimulus, the brain will decide what action has to be done. So in order to take an action in this regard, the brain has to remember. Brain can be regarded as a processing unit. So it must remember all the situation action pairs which it has gathered from its previous knowledge or experience. So it knows that since I am experiencing kind of mosquito bite on the skin, and which is a discomfort to me, so the action is being taken in our brain, and accordingly, we will try either we will beat that mosquito or let it fly. So once again, depending upon the severity of the situation or depending upon the discomfort, there could have been two different decisions. And which decision needs to be taken? Whether we will beat that mosquito or we will let them fly, that is also the discretion, or that is also the decision of the brain. And this entire operation or entire decision making thing is being done within a fraction of seconds. So you must appreciate that the number of operations, the complicated operations which are being performed inside the brain, is pretty large. And the decision making process is also very fast. And while you take a decision like this, that whether to beat the mosquito or let it fly, so this is not the only decision that your brain is making. Apart from that, maybe during that time, maybe you are having a phone call, you're talking to anybody, you are making a serious conversation over phone, and at the same time, you are facing a mosquito bite. So your brain is performing several actions parallelly. And based on that, several decisions are also taken parallelly. So the parallel computation is one of the essential and important features of brain. And this particular feature of the nervous system, biological nervous system, is exploited in the literature of artificial neural network. So what was the objective in the formulation of artificial neural network? The researchers have tried to make an analog, an electrical analog of what we have inside our brain, inside the brain of any living species. So we would like to replicate what is there already inside our brain, because we would like to train the system. We would like to make the system intelligent. System means we would like to train the machines. We would like to train the computers so that they can take their actions on their own. There should be a set of situation action pair. We must train the system, okay? If the situation is S1, then the action should be A1. If the situation is S2, the action should be A2. If the situation is S3, action should be A3, and so on. So a set of those situation action pair has to be there inside the knowledge base of the brain of the computer. So computer should be having a brain. I mean the machine. And that brain is modeled as the electrical equivalent of a biological brain. So if I just consider the architecture of brain, we know that the neurons are the fundamental units. Unicellular structure, so there is one cell within the neuron that is known as the cell body. So let me go to this particular slide. And this slide shows the biological neurons. So in fact, there are four different components in it. The first one is dendrite. So these are nothing but very small and thin fibers like thing, and which collect the stimulus from the nearby neurons or from muscles. And they will carry those neuro information. And there could have been a number of dendrites. And then these dendrites, after collecting those information from the nearby neurons or from muscle, they will transmit the information over a comparatively thick fiber, which is known as axon. And then this signal is computed over here, which is known as the cell body. And it is also known as the nucleus of the cell. So within a particular neuron, there is a single nucleus, single cell body. It is known as soma. And the output of this cell body, so depending upon the input, so obviously there will be some action which is performed inside the cell body. And right now, the human being is completely unaware about what the action is being done over here. But they have made several novel attempts to identify or to recognize the operation which has been done inside the cell body. And after that, the processed information from the cell body, from the cell, from the soma, it will be transmitted towards the next neuron. And one neuron and the nearby neuron, they are not connected directly. So what is there? We have a connection like this, a situation like this, where they are not connected directly. And this particular junction is known as the synaptic junction, or it is known as synapse. So actually, the flow of neural signal from one neuron to the other neuron is being controlled by some neurotransmitter. So it's a complicated chemical process. So depending upon the amount of neurotransmitter and the type of the neurotransmitter which is produced at the synaptic region, the signal, the neural signal from one neuron to the next neuron will be passed. So this synapse or the synaptic region will act like a potential barrier. Not all the signals which have been received over here will be transmitted to the next neuron. So it depends upon the type of the synaptic region, type of the synapse, and the amount of neurotransmitter, the type of the neurotransmitter, which will be produced at this particular range. So accordingly, we can have two types of neuroaction. One is known as excitatory action, in which case the amount and the type of neurotransmitter will be such that it will help the signal, it will help the neural signal to move from one neuron to the other neuron. So it will excite the post-synaptic neuron to receive the neurosignal, in which case it is known as excitatory. On the other hand, for a different combination of neurotransmitter, that means the amount and type of the neurotransmitter, the corresponding action would have been inhibitory. That means it will prohibit the flow, or it will restrict the flow of the neurosignal to pass from one neuron to the other neuron. So accordingly, there could have been two different actions. And synapse will act like a potential barrier in this regard. So in brief, if I take a look at the biological neuron, so there are four different components. One is dendrite, then we have the axon, then the cell body, soma, and the synapse. So this is all about the biological neuron, and within the brain, there could have been millions and millions of those neurons which are acting parallelly. And each of the neurons are made for different actions. As you know, inside the brain, we have different types of neurons. And to ensure that the brain will act properly, will function properly, those neurons must be active. Now, sometimes there are certain neurodegenerative disease which normally happen with the age. As the people grow older, within the brain, all the neurons, they might not be active. There could have been some loss of neuron. And since each of the neurons or a bunch of the neurons, they are capable to do some actions inside the brain. So if that portion of the neuron is somehow lost, or if it is damaged by some means, by for aging or some other reason, then the action of that particular human being will be limited, will be restricted. We may find that some older people, they cannot recognize things properly. They may forget something. They cannot do the actions properly, the motor action. Sometimes they lose their balance. So this is because of the malfunctioning of those neurons. Not all the neurons are faulty. Might be due to age. Some of the neurons might be faulty or inactive. And hence, the action cannot be taken properly, because the neuron or the brain or the nervous system, they will control each and every action of not only the human being, but also for other animals in the universe. So this thing I have already mentioned, there is a chemical in each neuron that is called the neurotransmitter. And the signal is transmitted across the neurons by this chemical. And depending upon the amount of neurotransmitter and type of neurotransmitter, there is a threshold value. That means whenever the total contribution of the signal, if I just go back, total contribution of the signal, suppose at this particular end, the total contribution of the signal is this much. Now, since the synapse acts like a potential barrier, that means there should be a threshold value. Now, if the signal component or the contribution resulting from different signals after processing within the cell body, when it reaches over here, if the value is below the threshold, we may think that the corresponding signal will not be propagated, will not be induced rather. I should not use the term propagated, rather induced, because these dendrites, they are not connected directly. So they are connected by means of the synaptic region. So there is no physical connection. So it will be better if I use the term induced. So the amount of signal or amount of neurosignal which will be induced to the next neuron solely depends upon the threshold value. If the threshold is made smaller, then the signal can be passed quite easily. And this is a kind of excitatory action. Now, if this threshold value is kept at a higher one, then you require a large contribution of signal over here so that it can be transmitted to the next neuron. So in which case, we can say that it's like a inhibitory action. So there should be a threshold. If I want to model the synapse or synaptic region, there should be a threshold value. And if the signal contribution is less than the threshold, signal will not be allowed to pass. And if it is more than threshold, then the signal will pass. So artificial neural network is nothing but the electrical analog of the biological nervous system. As I've already mentioned, the human brain is a highly complex structure. So there are a number of such neurons, and they are connected by an extensive connection. So massive number of neurons are there, and the way they are connected, it is very difficult to model. But once again, the people don't have any idea how to model this the biological nervous system. What they have identified, okay, if these are the inputs provided to the system, to a biological nervous system, this could have been the possible output. So accordingly, they have tried to model what could have been there inside the brain. But depending upon the stimulus, how does a particular neuron perform its operation? And accordingly, it takes a decision, is still a mystery to the biologist, to the medical researchers. So these AI people or the researchers working in this machine learning domain, they have tried to make a novel attempt. So in the very first day, I have mentioned the notion of this neural network or artificial neurons were made long back. In fact, this Widerhoff's adeline neuron was proposed in the year 1960, so almost 60 years back. But they don't have sufficient mathematical background behind their proposition to some extent. And as a matter of fact, over the years, this has been extensively studied by several computer scientists, and they have come up with the limitations of the previous models. And today, what we have got, so perhaps you know, nowadays people are talking about the deep learning methodology, deep learning technique. So this is the advanced model. So people have started with a simple neuron, then from the neuron to neural networks. And then now we are talking about deep learning model, the convolutional neural network. So this is possible, this becomes possible because of extensive study in mathematics, in computer science. So artificial neural networks, or sometimes we also refer like a neural network in short, NN. So these are nothing but the imitations of the biological nervous system. So people have tried, the computer scientists, they have tried to imitate, to replicate the action of a biological nervous system by means of a network, which they called as an artificial neural network. And obviously, while making this kind of model, it is to be motivated by the computing operation, which is generally performed within the human brain. So this particular slide shows the analogy between the biological neural network, that is BNN, and the artificial neural network, that is ANN. Already we have discussed about this one, these dendrites, cell body. We have a nucleus over here, an axon. And ultimately, we have a synaptic region at this particular position. So this is the biological neuron. This is a biological neuron, single biological neuron, which looks something like that. And this is the electrical equivalent. They have tried to model this biological neuron by means of some they are working with. For example, if I consider a single neuron, so there could have been a number of dendrites as apparent from this diagram. And each of the dendrites, they will accept different inputs from the nearest or nearby neurons. So the input which is being fed to a particular neuron or even for a artificial neuron is not a scalar quantity, so there could have been a number of such inputs as we see from a different entity. So one can model those inputs like x1, x2, x3, up to xn if there are n number of such inputs present. Now these inputs are being carried to the cell body and the corresponding weights are associated with that. And these weights are modeled like W1, W2, up to Wn. So these weights will tell you how efficient or how effective the dendrites are to transfer the signal, to transfer the neurosignal from the nearby neurons to the cell body. So the way they conduct the information, they conduct the signal, can be modeled by some weights. The contribution made by each of the dendrites may not be same. One dendrite might be efficient enough in transmitting the signal, but for the other dendrites, there could have been some attenuation during the transmission. That means some signal loss. So scientists have also taken this particular point into their consideration while modeling this artificial neural network. And they have associated a weight value with each of the inputs. For x1, it is W1, for x2, it is W2, for x3, it is W3, and so on. And then all of these signals, along with their weights, are being fed to the summation unit, and which has resemblance with the cell body. Initially, they have considered a weighted average kind of thing, so summation only. So one might argue that, okay, there could have been some complicated operation. But initially, they have started with a summation operation inside the cell body. So as you can understand, the output over here will be like W1 X1 plus W2 X2 plus W3 X3 plus dot dot Wn Xn. Or like summation I is equal to 1 to n Wi Xi mathematically. So this is the output of the cell body. And this output is being fed through a threshold unit. And this threshold unit is having its resemblance with the synaptic region, because it will act as a potential barrier. As I mentioned, the signal which are present at the presynaptic region, suppose this is neuron 1, and there is another neuron over here, second neuron. So the signal, the neurosignal will be induced from one neuron to the other neuron through this synaptic region by virtue of the amount and type of the neurotransmitter. So depending upon the type and amount of neurotransmitter and depending upon the amount of signal component which is present already over here, the corresponding signal will be induced to the next neuron. So since this is not a direct connection, so this connection is a nonlinear operation. This operation, this mathematical operation, which is being performed over here, is a nonlinear operation. However, this operation within the summation unit is a linear operation because you know this weighted average is a linear operation. W1x1 plus W2x2 plus W3x3 is a simple linear operation. However, this nonlinear behavior of the synaptic region is being modeled by means of any nonlinear function. So thresholding could have been considered as the simplest nonlinear operation. As you know, we have also discussed the notion of thresholding to some extent while talking about the classification. So suppose we have two different weights, a set of weights, and we have to identify the rat, or we have to classify the rats according to their weights, masses. So fix the threshold. Anything higher than the threshold will be categorized into class 1, and anything less than the threshold will be categorized into class 0 or class 2. So thresholding operation is the fundamental operation which is nonlinear in nature. And ultimately, the output will be developed from this particular neuron. So this is the model of a single artificial neuron. And whenever we talk about the neural network, perhaps in the next lecture, I'll be talking about the architecture of a neural network. Then you'll see that these neurons are connected in a particular fashion to make a sense about the entire structure of a brain. So the neuron serves this following operation. First of all, the dendrites, they will compute the input signal and they will transport the signals. And obviously, it will be stored inside the cell body. And depending upon that, there could have been different decision-making process as identified by the neural network. So the operation, the application could have been like perception, automatic training and learning. We will discuss each of these one by one. Once again, this artificial neural network, or rather an artificial neuron, has been shown here. So this has been mentioned already. What I would say, x1, x2, xn. So these are the n inputs of the artificial neuron. So don't get confused with the neural network and neuron. Neural network means a number of such neurons connected, interconnected in different fashion. And accordingly, we'll be getting what is known as a neural network. But this is the architecture of a single neuron. And W1 to Wn are the weights attached to the corresponding input links. So since the biological neuron receives all the inputs through the dendrites, sums them up and produces an output if the sum is greater than the threshold value, as I've already mentioned. So during the transmission, there could have been some acceleration or retardation. And this is modeled by means of weights, as I've already mentioned. And for synapse, which transmits a stronger signal, will have a correspondingly larger weights, and while a weak synapse will have smaller weights. So the weight of the synapse is not also fixed. If you transmit a stronger signal, the weight should be large, and accordingly, there is a high chance that the computed signal will be propagated, will be induced to the next neuron. So if I just consider the output of the summation unit, that means the output of the cell body of the artificial neuron is identified by I, then one can easily write it down like W1x1 plus W2x2 to Wnxn. And we have in a compact form that can be written like I is equal to 1 to n Wxi. So during our discussion in linear algebra, I have mentioned that we have to use the notion of matrix many times while talking about the neural network. But as you have got the essence of what I have said that time, the summation sign I is equal to 1 to n w x I. So that can also be modeled. So it is good with a single neuron, but if you have a number of such neurons in a interconnected network, then it will be convenient for us. It will be easier for us to formulate if the entire thing is represented by means of some matrix multiplication. Remember that each this x and w, they are vectors in nature, because we have say if I have n number of inputs, so x1 to xn, x1, x2, x3 up to xn, and n number of weights accordingly, w1 to w2, w3, wn, and the resultant output is a scalar quantity w1 x1 plus w2 x2 plus wn xn. So I can regard this input as a vector, say 1 cross n vector, and this weights as another vector, same dimension 1 cross n. Then perhaps you can remember what you have discussed that time. For two vector like E and for one vector like E, the corresponding inner product E transpose E. So the same thing can also be done over here. The same analogy can also be applied. We have two vectors, each of dimensions 1 cross n, assuming they are row vectors, one row and n columns, 1 cross n and 1 cross n. The final output I is nothing but a scalar quantity. So I have to represent them by means of this inner product. One vector is multiplied with the 1 cross n and n cross 1. And accordingly, the output will be developed. And this output Y is nothing but the output of this nonlinear function. So one can regard the nonlinear function as any function phi. So the output Y is nothing but phi of I. So there are different types of nonlinear function, which we will discuss. And Y is the final output, as I mentioned. So in regard to those nonlinear function, thresholding is the most common nonlinear function which is performed at the synaptic region. And over the years, people have considered thresholding to be the only alternative model to be represented as at a synaptic region. Now, if I just take a look at the threshold unit, the input to the unit is I, which is the output of the summation unit or output of the cell body. Now the output is Y for the overall neuron. Now since it's a threshold unit, so we must have some threshold value theta, for example. Now if the value of I is greater than theta, then the output will be 1, else it is 0. Or sometimes you can also regard like 1 and minus 1. So in other words, since it's a single threshold, single point threshold, so accordingly the output will be divided into two different classes. Now if the input to the threshold unit is higher than the threshold, then I can model the output by means of some variable. And if the input to the threshold unit is less than the threshold value, then I can model it by some other value. So here, two values are considered to be 1 and 0. So if the value of I is greater than theta, then the output is 1 and else it is 0, just like a simple linear filter. So one can write that Y is equal to mathematically phi of I is equal to 1 to n w x I minus theta. So this is the input I, input to the threshold unit, I is equal to 1 to n w x I. And this theta is the property of the threshold unit. It will be there inside the threshold unit. And the property is that phi of I will be equal to 1 if I greater than theta, and 0 if I less than equal to theta. And this is called a step function. Why step function? Because if you know what is step function, perhaps the people from electrical or electronics background, they have the knowledge about the step function. So for the step function, if the argument is greater than, for a simple step function, I'm not talking about the shifted step function, like u of t, if the input value, if the argument is greater than 0, then the output will be 1. And if the input is less than or equal to 0, then the output will be 0. This is the property of step function. And if I consider a shifted step function, in that case, some shift value is provided. So if the input is greater than the shift, then the output will be 1. And if the input is less than or equal to the shift, then the output will be 0. So as simple as that. So this is the pictorial representation of step function. Here, theta is equal to, non-zero value of theta has been considered. So if the input exceeds this particular value of threshold, then the output will become 1. And if the input is less than the threshold, then the output will be 0. And if I shift the value theta to 0, then it will be a perfect step function, not a shifted one. Now, as I mentioned, there could have been two different classes, like plus 1 and 1 and 0. So otherwise, you can model the output of a neuron by plus 1 and minus 1. And in which case, it is known as a signum type of transfer function. It's a very well-known transfer function in mathematics, signum function. Normally, the signum of x, SGN x, is equal to 1 plus 1 if x is greater than 0. And that is equal to minus 1 if x is less than 0 with no shift. So if the argument is greater than 0, then the output will be plus 1. And if the argument is less than 0, then the output will be minus 1. But you can also associate some, you can also modify the structure of the, the mathematical model of the signum function by introducing one threshold value, theta. Now, in case the argument is greater than theta, then it will be plus 1, and less than theta or equal to theta, it will be minus 1. Obviously, there is a discontinuity at theta. Now, these transfer functions, they are known as hard limit transfer function. Why hard limit? Because there are two levels. So if I consider a threshold value theta, and if the input is slightly higher than theta, like theta plus some delta, then the output will be moved to a particular class, plus 1, for example. And if the input is slightly less than theta, like theta minus delta, then it will be regarded, or it will be moved to another class, like 0. So the output value is very much sensitive to the input, which is close to theta. The value of the input, which is very large than theta, so you don't have any problem. It will be always regarded to plus 1. Or if the value of input is small, pretty small as compared to theta, then also no problem, that is 0. But however, the input which is lying close to this threshold value, that is theta, then there is a possibility of misclassification. Either you go to plus 1 or you go to 0. Either you go to plus 1 or you go to minus 1. And that is one of the limitations of this hard limiting transfer function. Then people have thought, okay, what we can do is that, so we need to identify, or we need to model the synaptic region by means of a nonlinear function. So it is true that the signum function or step function, they can be regarded as the most simple and the most popular nonlinear function. That is true. But they are having the limitation that the value of output is very much sensitive to the input value, which is close to the threshold. So instead of using a hard limiting transfer function like this, one can also use some. So in this particular slide, the hard limiting transfer function, as we mentioned, as I've already discussed this one. So instead of considering this hard limiting transfer function, the people have considered other nonlinear transfer function. And one such popular transfer function is the sigmoid transfer function. So unlike this hard limiting transfer function, which is discontinuous at the threshold value, this function, this transfer function, is a continuous function and it varies gradually between the two bounds. The bounds could have been like 0 and 1, which is known as the log sigmoid function, or minus 1 and plus 1, which is known as the tan sigmoid function. So this phi of L, this log sigmoid function, it is written like 1 by 1 plus e to the power minus alpha L. So one coefficient has been inserted here to control the corresponding swing from 0 to plus 1. So as you understand, when L value, the input, if it is 0, then the output will be 1 upon 2, that is 0.5. And if the input is very large, in that case, the output will become 1, because e to the power minus L, e to the power minus alpha L. So if L is very large, then this e to the power minus alpha L can be regarded to be 0, can be approximated to be 0, and the output will become plus 1. And if L is very, very small, then we can find the resultant value close to 0. So in order to control the shape of the function from 0 to 1, so one can insert this this coefficient alpha. So it is also important how to find out the value of alpha. Even if you fix that particular model, log sigmoid model, to model the synaptic region, then the value of alpha is also important. How to select the value of alpha, which will control the shape of the waveform. And another one is the tan sigmoid function. So mathematically, you can easily prove that the value will range from plus 1 to minus 1. Mathematically, it is given by e to the power alpha L minus e to the power minus alpha L divided by e to the power alpha L plus e to the power minus alpha L. So these are the two functions, log sigmoid transfer function and tan sigmoid transfer function. So log sigmoid will look something like that, 0 to 1. And as you increase the value of alpha, you find here, for alpha is equal to 0.3, you have a particular kind. So alpha is equal to 10. So if alpha is very large, then what happens? As you increase the value of alpha, ultimately, you are getting this hard limiting function. So depending on the value of alpha, the corresponding gradual distribution of the shape of the output changes accordingly. And that is also true for the tan sigma transfer function. So we can consider different values of alpha. If alpha is equal to 0.3, so it will be something like that, this graph. Then alpha is equal to 0.5, the dotted one. And if you make it alpha is equal to 1, then it is approaching closer to this hard limiting function. And if you increase it further, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, if you make it 10, so it can be shown that it is close to this red line. That means the hard limiting function. So accordingly, you have to select some value of alpha. And it is a common practice to select a fractional value of alpha less than 1, 0 to 1. And alpha is a positive quantity here. Now let us try to understand what are the advantages of this artificial neural network. So one of the biggest advantage for which people have used this artificial neural network in the course of machine learning is that it can exhibit the mapping capabilities. Whenever we will be talking about the neural network, then you'll see that there are a number of neurons connected in some fashion. So depending upon the input pattern and the corresponding output pattern, provided that we are following some learning strategy. So both the input pattern and the output pattern is being given to the system, is being given to the neural network model. Then the ANNs can map the corresponding input output pattern by means of some model. So this is one of the biggest advantage, as you understand, and it can learn by examples. So learning is the essential feature by means of which one can train a system. As I've already mentioned in one of the lectures, that if you are a good learner, a quick learner, that means from the experience already perceived by you, you can readily identify what are the mistakes, and accordingly you will be able to take the proper actions. So learning is an essential feature by means of which one can train a system. And within the ANN architecture, we do have this learning capacity. So an ANN architecture can be trained with the known example of a problem before they are tested for their inference capabilities on unknown instance of the problem. That is normally done. Actually, it has been inspired from our day-to-day activities. Even if you do some unknown activity, we need to have some experience regarding what has to be done. So there are two different notions, as we already know. One is the training pattern or training data set, and second one is the testing data set or testing pattern. So before they are tested, before the neural network is tested for some unknown instance, for some unknown situation, it is previously trained with the known samples. And it is all about modeling those neurons and the neural networks. Because here you are going to map the input with output by means of some function. If you can remember the model which we have talked about in the second day perhaps. In case of machine learning, the data and output is being provided at the input of the system and the input of the computer, and you need to develop the corresponding program. So for artificial neural network, what do you have? You have the neurons as a basic block, and these neurons are connected by some means, and ultimately you have got the complicated structure, which is known as a neural network, artificial neural network. So if I want to model this one for a particular set of input and output, so we need to know what should be the proper architecture. We'll be discussing the ANN architecture in the next lecture. So architecture has to be known to you, what could have been the possible architectures. And secondly, even if the architecture is fixed, then within the architecture, you do have the neurons, then how to model the neurons. That means, if I consider the synaptic region, in fact, a lot of research has been carried out to model the synapse function. How can you model? Hard limiting, soft limiting. Even if soft limiting, what should be the parameters? So it has been found that for different applications, different types of learning, I mean, different types of modeling is efficient, is effective. So this entire thing is performed for a number of sets of inputs and outputs. And once the system designer is happy with the training pattern, once he's convinced that, okay, now the system is able to learn, then the new pattern is being provided for the checking purpose. And the artificial neural networks can also possess the capability to generalize. So that is a very important aspect, because everywhere it is not possible for you or any one of us to find out the exact mathematical model to find out a solution. If it is obtained, then ultimately the notion of neural network or the notion of problem solving will be nothing but the notion of computation. So if you know the mathematical model well before the solution, then given the data and given the problem, given the mathematical model, you can easily find out the solution. Nowadays, the computational part is not that tricky. We have computers, we have computing devices, which are fast enough. So it's not that it will take 8 hours or 10 hours to solve a problem. So we can do it very easily. Lots of mathematical tools, lots of simulation models have come up, so it is not a problem. But the problem is that if you do not have the mathematical model, then how can you do that? Sometimes you need to generalize. And as far as the generalization is concerned, this artificial neural networks possess an essential capability to generalize. Now, this system is a robust system and fault-tolerant system. So what do you mean by fault-tolerant? If you look at different applications of neural network or machine learning, you'll see that one of the applications or one of the examples I have shown in the introductory lecture, where the object is to identify the number 2. Given a set of numbers from 0 to 9, they are arranged within a particular image. And the task of the machine learning system is to identify the recommended pattern, which is 2. Now, obviously, not all the patterns are complete. Most of the patterns are partially true. Partially understandable, and there are some noisy patterns as well. If I just compare the actual number with that one, you'll see that there are a lot of increments, a lot of deviations from ideal patterns. We know that 2 can be written like this, 2 is like this, but we have found that some distortion has been placed over there. But still, because of this fault-tolerant capability of this artificial neural network, it has been found that they can recall the full patterns from the incomplete, partial, or noisy patterns. And the another important aspect of ANN is that, which we have started with, so they can run in parallel, and it is known as distributed kind of computing. If it is fault tolerant, so distributed kind of computing, so same output is being shared with different nodes within the network. So even if there is one node is not functioning properly, then also, since the output is being shared with many of the nodes, then the system becomes fault tolerant. It will become robust. And there are a number of such neurons in parallel. So it's a massive parallel distributed system. And a number of interconnected neurons are there, which can act in parallel. And ultimately, it can provide us a nice model to deal with, so that one can learn properly and acquire as much knowledge as possible. So these are the important attributes of artificial neural network. And ANN has been used over a number of years to solve a variety of problems. And now today, the concept of ANN, artificial neural network, has been modified significantly, and people are talking about the convolutional neural network, people are talking about deep learning. And nowadays you find a lot of applications of deep learning in many of the areas under consideration. So with this, I have come to an end of this introductory lecture to artificial neural network. And in the next lecture, I'll be talking about the architecture of this artificial neural network.